church is going to be dismissed.
So it's good to be in God's house. You know, sometimes we do forget to praise Him for the little things. Sometimes we praise Him for the great things He does in our life, but boy, it's the little things that gets us from day to day. It's the little things that we look back and say, Lord, thank you, Jesus, for another day. Thank you for letting me go walk across the floor, talk, walk. We just don't know what really could lie in store for us, how much God really blesses us. We don't know sometimes, we don't give Him enough credit. It's untelling how many times between the house this morning and by the time you got here, how many times God diverted Satan from trying to take you out of this world. Do you realize that? Do you realize just how blessed you are? See, if we saw everything that God sees, it'd scare us to death, wouldn't it? It would scare us to death. So that's the reason why we don't. But don't let nobody kid you that God's hand is on each and every one of your lives this morning. If you're saved in here, we never make it another day without God. We never have a chance to go to heaven without God. But if you're lost in here, let me tell you this morning that God's hand's still about you. If not, Satan would have already taken you out of this world, and you would have already known what it would have been like to be one on your way to hell. Now think about that this morning. God's good this morning. He's worthy of our praise. As I said this morning, we all get our minds on all kinds of stuff. Satan uses the busyness of this world, I think, and the busyness of our lives to detract us from what's important. We know, we get afraid sometimes when, I know a few weeks back when it was laying off at Pikeville, and I may be the next one tomorrow, we don't know. But I was all concerned about it. Then I realized that whether I have a job or not, I'm not promised tomorrow. I may not have a life tomorrow. Well, I worry about what a job's going to bring or not bring. If I can trust my God to hold my life in His hand, surely I can trust Him to get me through whatever tomorrow holds, right? So we forget that sometimes. But God's good this morning. I thank God this morning that He allows you to be here. I pray that God would speak to you somehow through this sermon this morning. That I pray and I ask God what He wants me to preach, and this is what He's put up on my heart. So I pray that God speaks to somebody in here through this, and that we would leave here knowing that God loves you. That more than anything else in this world, that you got a friend in Jesus. So this morning, if you would, I'd like for you to turn with me to the 25th chapter of Matthew. We're going to start in the very first verse. We're going to read about 12 verses, if it be the Lord's will. If you'll stand, we're going to read the God's Word. Now, we all know this one, and I've even preached on this before. But this is where God put me to preach this morning, that be His will. So I desire your prayers. We can't do anything without Him, but Lord willing, we'll try our best. So in the 25th chapter of Matthew, the first verse says, "Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened." Now this is Jesus speaking, by the way. "Then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, Behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go ye out to meet him. Then all those virgins arose, and they trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, Give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answer said, Not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. And they that were ready went in with him to the marriage. And the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgins, saying, Lord, Lord, open to us. But he answered and he said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Praise God, you may be seated. Now, like I said, I've preached on this before, and I think I've even preached here on this before. It's been a while. But as I thought about this, and it's been on my mind and my heart for the last few weeks, actually, and as I thought about it and I prayed about it, I started thinking about what this is saying here. I remember last year we went on a little trip, some of us at the church here, and we went down to Pikeville, and we got to see some artifacts that they found from biblical times. Now, every time I heard this preached, and every time I preached on it, I've always pictured this lamp that these virgins was carrying as a lamp like me and you use today. Or maybe one of the old coal lamps that was pretty good in size and had quite a bit of space for the oil on the bottom of it. But as we went there, I realized as we went through these antiquities and we was looking, they showed us the lamp that this time period was talking about. And I actually have one here today. This is the lamp that it was talking about. This is the size that they used at that time. Now, I want you to pay attention to this pretty close, because first of all, it's tiny. And it's tiny. Not near what I thought it would be. I thought it would be a big, huge one, like I said, with maybe a big, huge place to put your oil. But it wasn't. It was small, just like this. But in a dark, dark world, this little light put out a lot of light, huh? In a dark place. Now, some of you in here are coal miners, been coal miners in your time, or maybe been in a coal mine. You never know pitch dark until you've been in the coal mines. You get in the coal mines, cut your lights off, you can't see your hand in front of your face, literally. It's that black. And a little lamp like this will put off a lot of light. But as I thought about this, and I thought about what the Bible was talking about, Jesus was telling them this prayer. And it was telling them that there was 10 virgins that left that day. Go out and meet the bridegroom. Now, I started thinking about that. You know, there was 10 people saved the morning I got saved. Now, I want you to know something. I hope and pray that they all were saved. I know they all bent their knee. But of those 10 virgins the Bible was talking about, I want you to know they all left with the same thing. They all left with their lamps, and they all left with their lights. When I prayed that morning, I left, praise God, from that town when I raised my knees up that morning at that little church in Seco. I left, praise God, with my lamp full of oil. I left, praise God, with my light a-shining. I want you to know, honey, when these 10 virgins started out, they all started out the same. They all had the same lamps. They all had the same fluid in the inside of them that made them burn. And they all, praise God, had a light to go when they started. But the Bible says, praise God, as they waited on the bridegroom, and he turned. I want you to know something this morning. As we're waiting on Jesus Christ, we often say, I don't understand why he's not come back yet. He's tarrying yet to come and get his bride. But I want you to know something. God knows the reason. He knows, praise God, if just one more soul would be saved between now and when he comes back, it would be worth it all. But I want you to know something this morning. You have a light just like this little light. Praise be to God. It may be little and it may be small, praise God. But I want you to know something. It'll put off a mighty light in a mighty dark place this morning. I want you to know, as they left out, they all had their lights and they all had them burning and they had fuel in the inside of them, just as me and you did when we got saved. But along the way, praise God, there was five that Jesus called wise and there was five that Jesus called foolish. Now I want you to know something. And you can look around this morning. And you can tell me how many family members that you used to see sitting in this church. Now there may be some that's going to the church. I'm fine with that. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the ones, praise God, that used to serve God. And now, praise God, serve nothing but their self. Now serve nothing but Satan. The ones that somewhere along the way, they wasn't vigilant with their little light, praise God. There wasn't vigilant with keeping the oil in their little lamp. And somewhere along the way, the little lamp went out. Now I want you to think about the ones that just you know, that maybe from this church you've seen come and go. I know in the last 16 years or 17 years that I've been in church, I sit and I think about all the people that I've seen come through churches and go and bend a knee at an altar. And now, later on in life, I see them out somewhere. And God knows I'm no judge of them. But I don't think they're living the same life that they was living when they was coming to church. I don't think, praise God, they're still lifting up God's name. I don't think they're being the lights of the world that were put here to be. I don't think that they took good care of their little lamps. And as I seen these little lamps, it spoke to my heart. Miss Judy gave me this one, by the way. She bought it while we was down there that day, and she gave this one to me when she left. But as I looked at these little lamps down there, it just amazed me, praise God. And it come to me that day, that one day I'd preach on this message, if it be the Lord's will. It come to me just how vigilant, praise God, they had to be to keep their little lamps full of oil. I want you to know something this morning. People preach all the time, once saved, always saved. I'm going to tell you this morning, it's not Bible. I'm going to tell you this morning, praise be to God, you better start out with a full little lamp. But honey, if you don't take care of it and you don't tend it, somewhere along the way, your little lamp will go out. I can tell you right now, you can fool yourself all you want. You can think, praise God, it's got dimmer around you, and you can think that it's just maybe your eyes growing old. But maybe, praise God, it's your lamp growing low. Oh no. Maybe it's because you're not keeping a good vigilant watch over what God's given you. Listen to me this morning. It's important for you to know this. It's important for me to preach this to you. It ain't popular. What I preach sometimes not popular. I met Brother Tim up at the Tim Mullins up at the cell service this morning as I came in. I was talking about church. Talking about all churches, period. Not just this church. But he asked me how things was going. I said it's going good, but I don't have as many people as I'd like to have. He said, maybe you're not preaching, or you're not telling what they want to hear. Listen to me. I love each and every one in this room. I love everyone that's been in this church since I've been here. Everyone that I know, praise God, that's been here and now's not here. I love each and every one of them still today, just like I did then. But I want to tell you something. If none of you show up tomorrow or the next Sunday, I want to tell you something. It's important that I get a message to you. It's important that I tell you the truth. You know what I told Brother Tim? My hands will be clear. My hands will be clean. I'm going to preach just what God tells me to preach. And praise be to God, I hope you love it. And I hope it feeds your soul. And I hope you leave here shouting. And I hope, praise God, you go out and tell somebody. Woo! And I got a preacher that never fails to tell me the truth. But if you don't, praise God, I'm still going to preach the same message to you. If you keep showing up, you're going to hear it. And one sweet day, when you stand before Jesus Christ and He says, come in. You've been faithful over a few things, praise God. Come on into the joys of heaven. Then you can say, thank God for people like Brother Green. They didn't fail to tell me the truth. I want you to know something this morning. Your little light, your little lamp, it has to be taken care of. It has to be minded. It has to be watched over. It has to be taken care of. The oil that you carry, praise God, is precious. His name is Jesus Christ. That's the oil, praise God, that makes your little light burn. That's the oil this morning that keeps you on the path this morning. That, praise God, is more precious this morning than the next bite of food that you're going to take. It's more precious this morning than the next breath of air that you're going to breathe. That all that's within the inside of you that makes your light burn. Jesus came into this world, a light, in a dark, cold world. And the world received Him not. Listen to me. He came in and He shined a bright light. And it hurt their eyes, Brother Jim. It hurt their eyes because it made them suddenly see what they wasn't seeing. It made them suddenly realize what they wasn't realizing. And they didn't like it any. Jesus Christ had an obligation. People say, He didn't owe us anything. You're right, He didn't. He didn't owe us anything. He still don't owe you anything. But He had an obligation to God the Father. God the Father said, Son, they're going to die lost. There's no way. They can't live good enough. They can't be good enough. The world's too dark. And they're going to die lost. And I need you to do something for me. I need you to go. And I need you to go down. And I need you to pay the price for them.
He was obligated to God. Jesus Christ's obligations led him to a cross on Calvary. Me and you, when we got saved, we met Jesus Christ at the foot of that cross that he died upon. The foot of that cross that represents our salvation. That's where me and you met him. And when Jesus met his obligation on that cross, when you picked up your salvation that day, your obligation just began. You're not obligated to Jesus Christ. You're not your own no more. You're bought, you're paid for. You're someone else's. You have an obligation. What's your obligation, Pastor? What do you mean, my obligation? Jesus Christ no longer walks this earth. Me and you walk this earth. We're called Christians because we're supposed to be Christ-like. We're called Christians because we're supposed to follow this man named Jesus. We're called Christians because he gave us a light in the inside of us that this world can't darken. He gave you a light, praise God, that will show no matter where you're at. He gave you a light, praise be to God, that you can't buy on Amazon. You can't get it on eBay. I'm a light guy. I like lights. I got lights all over the house. I got lights that goes on my head. I got lights that sticks, that's magnet. I got lights that you can bend and mold and shape. I love lights. I hate a dark room. My wife drops at me all the time. They're coming to my house. You follow me. You know what room I've been in because the lights are still on. Ask her to tell you the truth. I hate a dark house. I hate a dingy space. Let me tell you something this morning. God didn't put you here, praise God, to be dingy lights. He didn't put you here this morning to be able to barely show off enough light, praise God, for you to be able to stumble around in the dark trying to figure out where you're going. No, sir. God saved your soul this morning so you could be a bright light, praise God, not only for your path, praise be to God, but for the ones who may be watching. Listen this morning. It's not always popular to preach what thus saith the word of God. It's not always popular to tell people the truth. But I'm telling you the truth this morning. The truth that God gave to me, I'm just passing it to you. I'm nobody and I'm worth nothing. And I can tell you that with a shirt. But if God tells me to tell you something, I'm going to tell you. You put the light. Just because you started out with it burning bright, don't mean it's still burning bright. Don't let Satan fool you into thinking that the world's just changed. It ain't your life. Your life's fine. The world's just changed. Don't let Satan fool you into thinking that, praise be to God, it might have been a sin a long time ago, but things is different. Things is different. Don't let Satan feed you lies this morning and get you into hell. Don't let him fool you enough, praise God, to make you wait too late. Listen to me. If you had everything you ever wanted on the face of this earth, and you died lost, and you died without your little light burning for Christ, what did you accomplish? Everything you have will burn. Your cars you drive, they're going to melt. The houses you built, they're going to burn. The bank account, praise God, that you rely upon, it's going to diminish and it's going to go away. And if it don't, somebody else is going to spend it when you die. But that life that Jesus Christ gave you, that eternal life that he gave you, if you'll take care of it, if you'll mind it, if you'll be obligated to him, if you'll keep filling your lamp, praise be to God, that light will burn eternally. And your life will go on. Jesus said those who follow him, praise God, they wouldn't die. Listen this morning. They told you, they said, well, how about the saints before they died? Look at Abraham, he died. Look at Moses, he died. This old earthly body may shed. I may shed this thing. It may fall off of me, praise God. It may rot and the worms may eat it. But honey, don't let nobody lie to you. This life didn't end when I lay down in that casket. This life didn't stop there, praise God. I'm going home this morning. I'm going to be with God in heaven. And it's because, praise God, He said I could. It's because one sweet day, and He filled me up for the life given for Him, praise God. That allows me to burn a light no matter where I'm at in this world. Listen this morning. How's your lamps this morning? How's your lights this morning? There's 10 virgins to start out with. They all started out with the same little lamp. They all started out with a burning bright. And you know what? With their light burning bright, they knew exactly where to step. They knew exactly where to go. Have you ever tried to do something in the dark? It's almost impossible. In the middle of the night, I get up. As I'm getting old, I get up a lot. Bathroom. I got to walk down. I don't know how many steps it takes. I don't turn a light on. But yet, to this day, sometimes the boys leave something in the hall. Sometimes there be something somewhere that ain't supposed to be there. And I find it about 3 o'clock in the morning. Of course, Kim and the kids slip through. I could fall through the bottom of the stairs and die. And they still be asleep. But I got news for you. I got news for you this morning. Sometimes, in the dark, even though you think you know the way, there's something sitting there that you may not know is there. There's a pitfall there that you don't know. When your light gets dim, it's hard to see. I go feed an old dog that I have, usually midnight. I've told you all this before. I use my little headlamp on my head, usually. When it starts getting dim, it's aggravating. I can't see. I can't see what I'm doing. So I have to go buy new batteries. I have to get it recharged. Listen to me. Christians in here. I'm speaking directly to you this morning. Listen to me. Sometimes you need new batteries. Sometimes you need to go back to the well which you draw from. Sometimes you need to go back to the man who gave you the fluid to fill your little lamps up. Sometimes you need to get up on your knees and you need to say, God, I don't know what I've done, but I know, God, I'm not where I was. I know, God, my life don't shine the way it used to shine. I know, praise God, the things I used to see clearly, now it's fuzzy, praise God. Have you ever noticed that? The darker it gets, the more fuzzy you see. Praise be to God. When you get lost, when, praise God, your light starts growing dim, I want you to know something. Things that was clear before suddenly is not so clear. You realize that? The sins that used to be sins, they're not as clear as they used to be. Used to, when you done something wrong, boy, bang, immediately, I done wrong. I know I done wrong. I gotta make amends. I gotta ask them to forgive me. I'm not ever doing that again. And then there's a little lamp grows dim. We see that same sin. Suddenly, don't look as good as bad as it did before. Don't hurt as much as the first time we done it, right? Because our lives is going dim. And we're not seeing the whole truth. Not seeing the whole truth. These 10 virgins was out in the dark and they was looking, waiting for the bridegroom to come. And it tarried. And the Bible said, 5 were foolish and 5 were wise. 5 took the oil in their lamp. Yes, they did. But they took oil with them. This morning, are you taking oil with you? You taking Jesus Christ with you whenever you go? How do you do that? Well, first of all, He's always with you, ain't He? But second of all, how do you do that? How do you fill your lamp back up? Let me show you. This is how you fill your lamp back up. This is how you fill your lamp back up. How many of y'all have been filling your lamp? How many of y'all have put fluid in your lamp in the last little while? Besides coming to church and hearing what little few verses I read, and what a horrible job I do at it, but how many of you filled your lamps up in a while? I'm talking to the Christian, I ain't talking to the lost. How many? You don't have to raise your hand. I just want to make sure I make a point of it. How many? Listen to me. Jesus Christ filled your lamp full. And as long, praise God, as you keep going back to the well, as long as you keep going to the one who filled your lamp up, it'll stay full. The wick will stay trimmed. Praise God. Anybody know anything about a coal lamp? After you burn it, the wick gets kind of burnt on the ends, and it don't burn as bright as it used to burn. It puts off, praise God, smoke. And it tins up the whole, dinges up the whole inside of the glass on the modern day ones, don't it? And you can't see. And you got to go in and you got to trim that wick back to get to that brand new wick. Then you got a nice, beautiful flame that shows a light that everybody can see. How many in here needs to trim their wick this morning? I'm going to ask you a question. If the Lord come back today, if that bridegroom finally showed up, you know, that's what Jesus was telling them. Heaven is likened unto this. Listen, the bridegroom turned. They thought he wouldn't come, but they slept and they slumbered, the Bible said. I read it to you. They slept and they slumbered. How long have you been asleep and slumbered? My point of this is, this little light, it has to keep shining its light. You can't start off with a bright, beautiful light and expect it to last forever. It don't last forever unless you feed it with what it needs, and what it needs is Jesus Christ. What it has to be full of is Jesus Christ. What you have to be full of to put off the light you're meant to put off is Jesus Christ. The more world you put in there, it's like adding water to your oil. You put enough water in with your fuel, it won't burn at all. Won't burn at all. It's diluted. Water don't burn. The more world you get inside of your little lamp, the dimmer it gets. And the more you have the strength to see what you do, the more it becomes difficult to get up and come to church on Sunday morning. The more, praise God, it's difficult to get out on Wednesday night and come to church. The more that it's, praise God, difficult for you to tell the truth all the time. The more that it gets difficult to live the life in front of people that you're supposed to live. The more world you get mixed in with this little lamp, the less that little light burns. And before long, you're in the middle of a dark place, and you have no light, and you have no fluid to fill it up. And if you stay that way long enough, you'll end up being in the ultimate place with no light. You'll end up being in hell, and you'll lift your eyes in hell, as the rich man did. Praise God in the flames and in the torment and in the agony. Don't let nobody fool you into saying that if you were saved once you're saved. My Bible don't read that. My God don't say that. Don't let nobody fool you into believing that. The Bible's plain. What did he say happened? Well, it was really great. Is this what Jesus Christ said? You tell me what he was talking about. Okay. Then all the virgins arose, and look, verse 7. Then all the virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. Verse 8. And the foolish said unto the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps have gone out. They're gone out. They don't show light no more. We're in the dark, praise God. But the wise answered, saying, not so, lest there not be enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy it yourself. Go find your own oil. Praise be to God. I got my oil. His name is Jesus. Now listen, what happened? Go buy it yourselves. Verse 10. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. Now who is the bridegroom? Jesus Christ. He's coming back after his bride one day. We all believe that, right? Who's the bridegroom? And while they went away, the bridegroom came. And they that were ready, listen, they that were ready went in with him to the marriage. And the door was what? Shut. And this is what happens when the other five came. Afterward came also the other virgin saying, Lord, Lord, open us. We're the same ones that was waiting on you. And we let our lights go out. Open, let us in, let us in, let us in. Look at 12, what he said to him. But he answered and said, verily I say unto you, I know you not. Now you tell me what he was telling people there. What was he getting across in that prayer? That even though they started out with the same little lamps, even though they started out with everybody's lamp burning, there was five of them that was wise, and they kept filling their little lamps up. They was vigilant over what they had. And there was five, praise God, that wasn't so vigilant. There was five that forgot what filled their lights up, what made their lights burn. And they thought that Jesus would come before he did. And he waited, and he tarried, and he waited, and their little lights went out. And while they went to try to find how to fill them up again, the bridegroom came, and he took the five that was ready. Bible speaks plainly of it. Look in Matthew chapter 5. I got two verses here. We're getting ready to come to a close. Look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 13 and 14. This is what it says. Ye are the salt of the earth. Now it's talking about you, Christians. Ye are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its savor, if suddenly it's not salt no more, if suddenly it don't flavor no more like it used to, if it's not the same as it once was, if salt suddenly becomes something different, look what he says. It's lost its savor. Wherewith shall it be salted? What good is it? What can you do with it if it's lost its savor? It is thenceforth good for nothing. If you once was saved and you lost it, praise be to God, you're in bad shape. This is what it says. But to be cast out and to be trodden under the foot of men. If salt's no good for what it's made to be, it ain't no good, throw it out. Christians, if you're no good for what you're supposed to be, there'll come a day when you'll be tossed out. There'll come a day, praise God, when you're not going to make it into heaven. Listen to me. It's important this morning. We can lose everything we have on the face of this earth. They can come and get my car, my truck. They can have whatever I own, praise God, which ain't much. I own it anyway. My house, they can come and get it all. And I'll lose it, and yes, I'll suffer a little bit here, and it'll be a sad day, and I won't say it won't. But honey, when I make it in front of Jesus Christ, and he tells me to depart from thee, you worker of iniquity, I never knew you. Praise be to God, that'll be a sovereign day. That'll be a day. And not enough tears that you can cry will change his mind. Not enough pleading that you can plead will change his heart. He either knows you or he don't. You either are what you say you are or you're not. Too often, Christians, we like to walk in between. We like for a light to burn when we're over here. But we like to turn it down a little bit so we can blend in over here. Right? Listen to me. Your lights ain't made to turn up to down. Your lights are made to burn. They're made to burn bright as they can possibly burn. Look at the next verse. What it says. It says, ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill and cannot be hidden. Christians, this is talking to you. Let me ask you a question. Is your lights burning where they're supposed to be? Have you been vigilant enough to keep your other lamp full? I got news for you. If you ain't, you're going to miss the marriage supper. If you ain't, there'll come a day when the door will close. And it'll close for the last time. And while you're out busy scurrying around trying to figure out what God's name you're going to do, Jesus Christ will come. And he'll get those who's waiting and watch it. And the rest will be left behind. On the ark. Noah made the ark. The whole world laughed at him. The whole world laughed. They didn't know what in the world this man was building an ark. No rain, no nothing. What are you doing? You're crazy. But when the rain started coming, when the flood started racing, when the water started pouring in, and his family was on the boat, and God shut the door, and he sealed it. Boom! And I can't imagine how many fingernails were sticking at the side of that boat as they crawled and tried to climb their way to safety. When they finally realized it was too late. Please, don't wait too late. And I don't ever mean to come down on Christians hard. I don't ever mean to step on your toes all the time. And it seems like that's all God gives me. Preach this, preach this, preach this. It's so hard sometimes. I want to preach love and goodness. But I want to see you get to heaven. There's a reason God gives messages. Maybe for me. There's a reason God gives messages. You don't just
prayer with a gift. It's got a purpose. Somebody needed to hear it. Please. Of all things in this world, make of a surety that you're all right with God. Make of a surety that your little lamp's still full of oil. And that your little light's still around. Make that be the number one priority in your life. And I promise you, if you do that, your whole world will be better. I promise you this morning that if you'll make sure your life never goes out, there'll be a home waiting for you in heaven. I promise you that this morning. This Bible, I can back it up. I can show you that you have to keep going. So you're going to be equated to the five wives or the five foolish. Out of the 10 that were saved, the one that I was, I know two that still profess the name of Christ.